Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. You probably know by now that we study the Sabbath school lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And this particular series is for the first 3 months of 2016. It's a series about the great controversy in Scripture. It's entitled Rebellion and Redemption. And this particular lesson for March 5 of 2016 is a lesson number 10 entitled Paul and the Rebellion. That should prove to be very interesting. I hope you have your Bible handy because you want to make sure that we're quoting it accurately. As you probably know also, if you listen to this series very often, I tend to like to use the Bible prepared by the American Bible Society, the one entitled The Good News Bible, also known sometimes as the Today's English Version, so I'll be reading from that version. But let's begin with a word of prayer. Father, we gather around this table once again, seeking to understand better what you want us to know, sharing with many who are out there watching and listening and thinking, we hope, as we are here, attempting to represent you correctly. May we do so, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, this particular lesson, obviously, is about Paul, and it'll be primarily what Paul wrote about that has an impact on the great controversy. And you won't find this in your Bible study guide, but I thought we should start with 1 Corinthians 4, verse 9. For it seems to me, this is Paul writing to the Corinthians, that God has given the very last place to us apostles, like people condemned to die in public, as a spectacle. And that word spectacle in the Greek is theater, for the whole world of angels and of humanity. So what's he suggesting there? Our little world is the lesson book of the universe, sometimes called the theater of the universe because of that verse.
And why would we be kind of a lesson book?
Well, that's the question I wanted to ask you, so you got ahead of me.
Earth was created to teach the onlooking universe how sin works and how God works.
God, the entire universe is watching to see what is God going to do with this mess.
He had to do it. The reason he created this earth was because of he had to answer the questions that were raised before he created this earth.
Yep.
The questions are already out there.
So thinking about the enemy side now, yes?
So in this theater, God is the star and we're the kind of little supporting actors.
The extras.
Yes, that's correct.
That might answer some of the questions.
Yes.
So it was necessary for things to go wrong here for the lessons to be learned?
There's also a villain.
Jim is nodding his head over there.
There's also
a
villain.
That doesn't sound good.
It isn't
like saying
good.
We were set up here.
We chose it on our own. We chose it ourselves.
Well, how would the lesson have been played out? How would the lessons have been learned if we hadn't? Are we getting way ahead in our lesson here?
Yeah, we're getting way ahead.
Okay, well,
let's hold up.
Let's go back to the start.
Hasn't all intelligent creatures, the heavenly ones as well as earth, learned more about the love of the Creator because of the evil that has taken place, not only in the heavenly places but on this earth? Because it would have never been necessary for God to do what he has done 2,000 years ago and so forth, had it not been that. So we're ultimately better off, but we have some...
We're going to be better off.
Yeah.
Maybe not better off yet.
No, I'm not saying that. I'm talking about better off in the future.
Strange doctrine.
Well, let's think about this. What you say is true, but let's work our way through it. What do we know about God's opponent?
He's not too bright.
Well, hold on. He's an incredibly good deceiver. 2 Corinthians 11:14. Well, no wonder. Even Satan can disguise himself to look like an angel of light. So what does that tell us?
That's a power that they got from the Creator.
He is willing to use his incredible powers to deceive in whatever way he can. 2 Thessalonians 2:19. Preternatural. These are preternatural powers. It's good for us all to learn a new word every once in a while.
It's a pretty long one.
Preternatural means supernatural, but on the evil side. Okay?
Well, no wonder I didn't know that word.
You don't know anything about the evil side, right? But what is Satan's primary goal in the great controversy? What was his goal when he started the rebellion in heaven? He didn't have any idea about human beings yet.
He wanted Christ's position.
Yeah. He wanted to bring God down so he could take his position. Satan is not satisfied just to get humans to sin. He's been incredibly successful at that. He wants to defeat and defame God in any way he can. That's what the great controversy is about. He has been very successful at getting us as humans to sin. We are all sinners. And I give you a whole list of texts from the Bible there. 1 Kings 8:46. The most famous one, most familiar one, is Romans 3:23, but verse 10 in that same chapter, Romans 5, verse 12, 1 John 1, 9, 10, there's just a whole bunch of verses in the Bible that says we are a bunch of sinners. But since he has been ultimately defeated by the life and death of Jesus, he wants to delay the second coming as long as possible and take down with him as many people as he possibly can. So that's the battle we're in, okay? Satan is going to use every method he can, force, deceit, lying, pretending, whatever, and his goal is to hurt God as much as he possibly can. Jesus has already won the great controversy by what he did, and it makes Satan even more angry. So this lesson will focus on what Jesus Christ has done for us. That is wonderful good news, but it is only part of the great controversy. And I would like to look at several passages, some from Scripture, some from Ellen White, that talk about the larger scope of the plan of salvation. And I'm reading first from Ephesians 1, 8-10. In all his wisdom and insight, God did what he had purposed and made known to us the secret plan he had already decided to complete by means of Christ. This plan, which God will complete when the time is right, is to bring all creation together. How much does that include?
Everything in heaven and earth.
Everything in heaven and on earth with Christ as head. Going now to chapter 3 of Ephesians, verses 9 and 10. God, who is the creator of all things, kept his secret hidden through all the past ages, in order that at the present time, by means of the church, who does that include?
People on this earth.
Us.
He's talking about us. By means of the church, the angelic rulers and powers in the heavenly world might learn of his wisdom in all its different forms. Angels are learning about God from you and me. How does that make you feel? Colossians 1, 19 and 20. For it was by God's own decision, his own choice, that the Son has in himself the full nature of God. In other words, God chose to send not an angel, but himself down to this earth. Through the Son, then, God decided to bring the whole universe back to himself. Okay.
Is there any other alternative?
Well, if you can think of one, God couldn't.
I guess that's a pretty good response there.
God made peace through his Son's blood, that is his death on the cross, and so brought back to himself all things, both on earth and in heaven. Ellen White takes it quite a ways further in more plain modern English. Through the plan of salvation, a larger purpose is to be wrought out even than the salvation of man and the redemption of the earth. Through the revelation of the character of God in Christ, so what's he trying to do here?
Reveal himself.
Reveal the truth about God. The beneficence of the divine government would be manifested before the universe, the charge of Satan refuted, the nature and result of sin made plain, and the perpetuity of the law fully demonstrated. Ellen White said that many times, and we've repeated it almost none in all the times we've copied from her books. I quote again. Now, this one's a little more widely known. This is Patriarchs and Prophets, page 68 and 69, talking about the fall back in the beginning. But the plan of redemption had a yet broader and deeper purpose than the salvation of man. What does it say to you when something is broader and deeper?
something that has more significance than just the salvation of man.
It's a bigger issue, right? It was not for this alone that Christ came to the earth. It was not merely that the inhabitants of this little world might regard the law of God as it should be regarded, but it was to vindicate the character of God before the universe. If God is not proven to be what we know him to be, if Satan were right about God, would you even want to be saved? Would you like to live for the rest of eternity with an arbitrary, capricious, mean-spirited, you know, God? I wouldn't. To this result, his correct representation of God and his great sacrifice, its influence upon the intelligence of other worlds as well as upon man, the Savior looked forward when just before his crucifixion he said, "Now is the judgment of this world, now shall the prince of this world be cast out, and I, if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all unto me." Now you may have noticed that there's a word missing there. In the King James Version, what does it say?
All men.
All men. And the men is in italics for emphasis, right?
Nope.
It's in italics because it's not there. Okay? So Ellen White intentionally left it out. And what did she mean by bringing all back to Christ? The act of Christ in dying. Sorry. My computer's getting ahead of me. The act of Christ in dying for the salvation of man would not only make heaven accessible to men and women, of course, but before all the universe, it would justify God and his Son in their dealing with the rebellion of Satan. It would establish the perpetuity of the law of God. It would reveal the nature and the result of sin.
So many times with the last few paragraphs we've been reading, the word salvation, and remember that the biblical teaching about sin is that it is a disease. Mm-hmm. And if you have a disease, you don't need forgiveness, you need healing. And that's
right.
What the salvation means is healing.
Mm-hmm. And here's a really shocking statement, again from Ellen White. It was in order that the heavenly universe might see the conditions of the covenant of redemption that Christ bore the penalty in behalf of the human race. The throne of justice must be eternally and forever made secure. What does that mean?
It's what it says.
Here's what it says? Okay. In other words, God has to be shown to be right, even though the race be wiped out. Who is she talking about? Us, the human race, and another creation populate the earth. Now, some people can say that's complete heresy. Does the Bible say anything like that?
Sure hope so.
It does. Where do you find it? Romans 3:4. She's just expounding on Romans 3:4. And I quote, certainly, and he's been talking about the difference between the Jews and the Gentiles and so forth. And he says, does this mean that God will not be faithful? Certainly not. God must be true even though every human being is a liar. Okay? As the scripture says, you must be shown to be right when you speak. You must win your case when you are being tried. Even though every human being is a liar, that would mean lost.
Remember that verse 4 is talking about God, that God may win his case.
Yep.
God is the one that is being judged, not as the NIV says, may you make the right judgment call.
No,
the NIV is absolutely wrong. It's not the newly inspired version. It's the New International Version, so it's wrong at that point.
By the sacrifice Christ was about to make, all doubts would be forever settled and the human race would be saved if they would return to their allegiance. Christ alone could restore honor to God's government. The cross of Calvary would be looked upon by the unfallen worlds, by the heavenly universe, by satanic agencies, by the fallen race, and every mouth would be stopped. Who is able to describe the last scenes of Christ's life on earth? How many human beings saw and understood what was going on in the last 48 hours of Christ's life, or 24 hours? Zero. Zip. Who is able to describe the last scenes of Christ's life on earth? Who was watching his trial in the judgment hall, his crucifixion? Who witnessed these scenes? The heavenly universe, God the Father, Satan, and his angels. Who is the audience?
The unlocking universe.
Everyone except human beings. Signs of the Times, July 12, 1899, paragraph 2.
So what were they seeing besides suffering?
Well, they were seeing, yeah, that's a very good question. They were seeing Jesus in the middle of the toughest battle of the great controversy. God on one side, gradually backing himself away and letting Satan have access to Jesus, but not taking unfair advantage of the situation. And the rest of the universe is watching what Satan is trying to do to Jesus.
It's and a battle to accomplish what?
To show that Satan is a liar.
Yeah.
They had context of the situation.
Yeah. To realize that Jesus is going to die to demonstrate the truth about what God had said, that in the beginning, it said back in the beginning, if you sin, you will die.
That was a good statement there. They saw what was happening in context. I like that.
Yeah.
That's good.
Yeah, it's incredible that what's going on here. And Satan is a catch-22 because he wants to get Jesus to sin. He wants to torture him. He wants to do whatever he possibly can to get him to sin or to give up and go back to heaven. But he realizes that if Jesus dies, he's just lost. So how do you torture Jesus but not let him die? So Satan was delighted when an angel came down to the Garden of Eden and resuscitated Jesus. Satan thought he had lost it. Jesus was dying. Ellen White says he fell dying to the ground.
Well, also, prior to that, although this is the most dramatic evidence of God's love and so forth, but prior to that, we do have some human experiences of people who were faithful.
Mm-hmm.
So there's something to be said for the evidences of these people's lives.
Yeah.
And
Job is a wonderful example.
And Moses and Rahab and a lot of
people. Look,
so what lie, when they were seeing all that happen, I mean, what lie was being shown right then?
Just
how Satan was treating
Satan's lie that said sin will not cause you to die. Well, look at this, Hebrews 2, 14 and 15. And some people would argue about whether or not this was written by Paul. I believe it was. Ellen White believed it was. But anyway, whoever wrote Hebrews. Since the children, as he calls them, are people of flesh and blood, that's us, Jesus himself became like them and shared their human nature. He did this so that through his death he might destroy the devil who has the power over death, and in this way set free those who were slaves all their lives because of their fear of death. Now think about that. How does the death of Christ destroy the devil?
Well, it would seem you would have to have some kind of an idea, an understanding of what it means when the devil has, how was it you phrased it, control over death.
Well, but think about this. Satan's argument was, you can sin, it's all right, it's not going to kill you. And God says, oh no, it will kill you. So when Jesus died, proving that in fact sin leads to death, if God steps back from you and you're, in the case of Jesus, he wasn't a sinner, but he was treated as if he were a sinner. See, that's Isaiah 53, that's 2 Corinthians 5. He was treated as if he was a sinner, and he died. Satan's argument has just been blown, smattered to pieces.
And you're referring to the second death on this?
Yeah, the second death.
So if Jesus demonstrated that sin leads to death, mm-hmm. and he never had sin in him, mm-hmm. well, then how does that get to be a demonstration of that?
Because God treated him as if he were a sinner.
Then everybody is dying because of how God treats them.
No.
Well, because separation. You just said that about Jesus.
Well, okay.
Lay a finger on him.
And partly, but I guess
just
that.
He just said that he was.
Okay.
God was treating him.
You want us to go back through the whole Bible, but and I don't have time to do this, but I'll take you to one verse. It's found in Hosea 4, verse 17. And this is how God treats sinners. The people of Israel are under the spell of idols. Let them go their own way. when there's nothing more that God can do, he finally says, okay.
Romans 4:25.
Yeah.
So it's just God letting them go.
Exactly.
But it's not because of sin, it's because of God letting them go.
No, God has to let them go because they refuse to let go of sin. You want God to take sin to heaven? What do you want him to do with it?
They're tugging and pulling on his hand, so to speak, wanting to go some other direction, and eventually he just has to let go and let them go. Yeah. Whereas in Jesus' case, he was treated, which is kind of a funny word, but he was treated as a sinner, even though he was not a sinner.
Well, and it has to be that way because, and this is a little bit of a, you know, like you say, it's a little bit of a hard for us to wrap our minds around. It had to be like that because only Jesus, who was divine, could, after being dead, exercise his divine power and come back to life. Because if any of us die the second death, it's all over for us. There's no way. We don't have the power to come back.
Well, but if he's proving that death is a consequence of sin,
yeah.
I mean, it was happening all around the universe. Why? I mean, all here, all over the planet. Why couldn't they see that when the frogs and the squirrels and the leaves and the daisies and everything were dying?
Now you have to go through the Bible very carefully and distinguish between the first death and the second death. Jesus died the second death. And unfortunately, we don't have time to go through those details right now. But take my word for it. Go back and look for yourself. Jesus died of sin. He didn't die of heart attack, stroke, high blood pressure, diabetes.
When we refer to the first death, it's when you and I die here. Mm-hmm. And the Bible talks about a resurrection and so forth.
It talks about the first death, Revelation 20.
Right, and there'll be another time when talks about really the die as a consequence, ultimate consequence of sin.
Yeah, and that's in Revelation 20. If you want to read it, that's a chapter where it talks about first death, second death. Try to figure out which is the second death. So now it's come down to God, Jesus, by dying of sin, has just proved that Satan's arguments are completely false, and that thus he destroys the devil. Now, this is not an argument about who has the most power. James 2:19 tells us very clearly that, you know, the devils look at God's power and it scares them to death. They just shake with fear. But Satan will be completely defeated finally when everyone in the universe, including Satan himself, admits that God has been telling us the truth and that Satan has been the one lying to us all along. Philippians 2:8 and Romans 3:4. What are we talking about? Philippians 2:8? Let's look at that for a second. Jesus came down to this earth. I don't have time to read the whole chapter. He came down to the earth, he was humble and walked the path of obedience all the way to death, his death on the cross. For this reason, God raised him to the highest place above and gave him the name that is greater than any other name. And so in honor of the name of Jesus, all beings, how many?
All
beings. Does that include Satan?
It's all.
All. All beings, including Satan in heaven, on earth, and in the world below, nobody is left out, including Satan, will fall on their knees and all will openly proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Satan will finally have to bow down and say, yes, God, you are right. Well, coming back now to our situation, Romans 5:12 to 21 talks about the first Adam and the second Adam and how Adam's sin brings us all down and Christ's life brings us all up. How do you understand all that? But first of all, how did we get into this sin situation? According to the Bible, how did humans first get started? Even before humans, maybe, we should say.
Where did sin start?
Where did sin start? And how did it start?
It started with Satan,
what was called Lucifer in those days, in the very throne room of God in heaven. Yeah, Revelation 12:7-12. And without God's rescue plan, we all would die since we are all sinners and since sin separates us from God. Isaiah 59:2. So by his life and death, Jesus answered and defeated all of Satan's accusations and arguments against God. Thus it is possible for us to be saved, that is, healed. Jim, there you have it. By demonstrating to us the truth about God and revealing to us the truth about Satan, the life and death of Jesus give us a clear choice. We will choose to live our lives with the help of the Holy Spirit as best we can, or will we choose to live our lives with the help of the Holy Spirit as best we can in harmony with the life of Jesus, or will we choose to die as Jesus died as a direct result of sin? So in what sense does Adam's sin cause all of us to become sinners?
What do we call this?
Huh? DNA has changed.
Say genetics.
Good question.
Well, this is a thing that theologians have argued about for a long time called original sin. Are we guilty because of what Adam did?
No.
Or are we guilty because we do it too? Romans 5:12.
Well, why do we do it?
Something's happened.
You tell me.
Well, something switched, didn't it, when Adam did something? So in a way, that's kind of like original sin.
Yeah.
It was,
switch.
It was original at that point in history, but the part
Adam,
of that...
Adam and Eve were born...
switched so that we have a tendency to let
I'm going to tell you what it is right now. Okay. Adam and Eve were born in full cooperation and fellowship with God.
Isn't cooperation a decision?
Well, whatever. I mean, they walked with God every evening in the cool of the evening. They thought he was wonderful. They talked with him. I mean, what do you want to call that?
Untarnished.
Yeah.
Wouldn't that happen today if we could?
Well, it would be nice, but what's happened? They sinned. They got thrown out of the garden. We do not have the option of being born in the Garden of Eden.
Some kind of a spiritual virus.
Yeah.
Loose in the universe.
Well, it's kind of like original sin.
Yeah.
Kind of.
We are born in a sin-polluted world, unlike the births of Adam and Eve. But we have chosen to follow the sinful example of our ancestors. Thus, we share in their sinfulness and condemnation.
Oh, wait a minute.
Yeah?
In their sinfulness? We share in their sinfulness, their sinful tendencies, their genetic tendencies.
Well, their sins.
We're not guilty for their sins.
No.
Or the sins of Adam or any other human being.
We're guilty because we're sinners, just like they were.
Right, but we've got some virus or something that causes us to be kind of.
We're guilty.
Virus is the only term I can think of. Is something has affected the squirrels and the rabbits, the whole thing.
Right.
I'm worried about the squirrels and the rabbits.
Well, you know, they get sick and die too. They
didn't
eat any apples.
Let's talk about some of the explanations that people have given at different times. It is often suggested by Christians that Jesus won the great controversy by paying the debt for our sins. What does it mean to say that Jesus paid the debt for our sins? Paid the price for our sins, whatever, however you want to put that?
That's a pagan teaching.
Well, paying the price and paying a debt is kind of two different things.
Okay, take your pick. What does it mean?
Well, if you say paying the price, he did pay the price because somebody had to come down and show us which was the way, what was God was like, right?
Okay.
So if nobody wanted to pay that price, it wouldn't have ever been done. Okay. So you could say, in looking at it that way, that paying the price has to be done. But paying the debt, that's a little different.
Okay, well, so, to whom was it paid? Well, if you call it price or debt, to whom was it paid?
It was paid to the view, to be able to view it.
Huh?
Demonstration.
How is it going to be demonstrated if nobody paid the price to demonstrate it?
Do we owe anything to the devil? God owe anything to the devil?
No, that's why I'm saying it's a different... Paying the price is a little different than paying the debt, because now you're talking about paying the debt.
Well,
if it costs you something,
you pay a price.
And it's just like when you got to go in your classroom every day, you have to pay the price to get in there to teach your students something.
Mm-hmm.
So you're paying the price right then.
Jesus had to leave heaven.
It's Some days a bigger price
at
than
the hands of his creatures.
So yeah, but so, if you're talking about a debt, that to me seems a little different because somebody has to fork out the money to pay something.
So if Jesus paid the price for our salvation, couldn't he have paid enough so that everybody could be saved?
Salvation is healing, and the healing that needs to be done is the way people think about God. Mm-hmm. If we have the wrong concept, we have a pagan concept that somehow justice demands that somebody's got to pay a penalty, but that's totally pagan. Mm-hmm. And you can put all kinds of clothes on top of it. It's still pagan.
It's certainly not fair that we are in the mess we're in because Adam sinned.
No.
We were not there. We weren't a part of it, or Eve either. We had no part in their sins. But we ended up being born in sin. On the other hand, it's not fair that we receive a place in the kingdom of heaven. We had nothing to do with what Jesus did 2,000 years ago. So we're dealing with two unfair things.
But God is love, and he wants the best for all of his creatures. And the only way he can get that is to demonstrate, to teach. God is a teacher, not a penalty payer. Let's get over it.
In and of ourselves, we're not entitled to heaven.
No.
When we walk through the pearly gates, we're getting eternal life. And
not fair.
And life now and eternal life is a gift.
Yeah.
Even Adam and Eve in their perfection were not entitled to anything.
Yeah.
It's just
a
gift.
Romans 5 verse 8, but God has shown us how much he loves us. It was while we were still sinners that Christ died for us. So, I mean, you know.
And he planned that out before he created any intelligent creatures.
Yeah.
He knew what was going to happen, but God is love. You got to have the freedom to make a choice.
Okay, we suggested earlier that God is trying to say something to the universe through the church. Okay, listen to these words by Ellen White. This was from a letter she wrote December 23, 1892, sent to the General Conference to be read in the 1893 General Conference Bulletin. That's where we find it first. It was so good that they read it again in the 1899 General Conference Bulletin. She was still gone. The Church of Christ, enfeebled and defective as it may be, is the only object on earth on which he bestows his supreme regard. What does that say to us?
He's placing a lot of hopes and dreams in us.
Yeah.
Down here.
How well are we doing at representing him?
Well, some of us do a better job than others.
The job of teaching all others is human beings, finite beings in time and space.
Matthew 5:16 says what?
I'll have to look it up.
I do a very good job of teaching people what not to do.
I see.
Light so shine real.
I think that's let your light shine.
Let your light shine before men that they may see your good deeds and glorify you and your church, the local church and the general conference.
Your Father in heaven.
Glorify your Father in heaven. That's the one we're supposed to be representing. In 1 Corinthians 3, Paul talks about how the church is supposed to grow. Someone waters it, someone plants it, etc., etc. But who is the one that's ultimately responsible for the way it grows?
Yeah.
This isn't a secret.
Yeah.
Who's responsible for the growth?
It's ultimately God.
God is the one who's responsible ultimately. We just do our little part. How does that fit with Matthew 7:24-27? So then, anyone who hears these words of mine and obeys them is like a wise man who built his house on rock. The rain poured down, the rivers overflowed, and the wind blew and hard against that house, but it did not fall because it was built on rock. But anyone who hears these words of mine and does not obey them is like a foolish man who built his house on sand. I mean, it's so much easier. Why do we have to build on rock? The rain poured down, the rivers overflowed, the wind blew hard against that house, and it fell. And what a terrible fall that was. Right? These verses make it very clear that we need not only to hear, but also to obey God's word. Building our spiritual temples on the rock of Jesus Christ. Not only our personal ones, but as a church. These passages here are all in the plural. So, 1 Corinthians 12, Paul compares us not just to a building, and I should go to one other place, which is not mentioned in our lesson, just real quickly. Look at Ephesians verse 20. Just to give you a little more idea about how God wants us to build. You too are built upon the foundation laid by the apostles and prophets, the cornerstone being Christ Jesus himself. So who's the cornerstone?
Jesus.
And who is the rest of the foundation built on?
Apostles
and prophets. And we are bricks or stones or whatever in the walls. Do we want to be a part of God's church or don't we? If we want to be a part of it, then we need to be built on the foundation of Jesus Christ and established based on the teachings of the apostles and prophets, right? Well, in 1 Corinthians 12, verses 12 to 26, Paul says the different people in the church are like members of the body, eyes, ears, hands, feet, etc. All of us are given different talents. And what's the purpose of those talents? Does God just sort of close his eyes and pass out gifts?
He's supposed to use them in building the church.
They're supposed to be used in building up the church. How well are we doing at that?
There's always room for improvement.
The biggest room in the world is the room for improvement?
I do a lot every time I come and contribute to this broadcast.
There you go. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Well, Paul says in that chapter of 1 Corinthians 12, what would it be like if we were all ears or we were all eyes? Not all eyes in the sense that we're all paying attention with our eyes, but if there was just the church was just one big eye or the church was one big foot. I mean, what good would that be? God is the one who gives us spiritual gifts. We are not allowed to pick which gift or gifts we would like to have or what gift or gifts God should give us. But if we use our gifts or talents as God intends, they will do what?
Multiply.
Some people suffer from what we call autoimmune diseases. An autoimmune disease occurs when one organ or part of the body fights against another part of the body. It is usually the immune system fighting against one of the solid organs. That's typically what happens. These diseases can be very difficult to treat. It's the same way when a part of the church body attacks another part of the church body in one way or another. And what does that cause in God's mind?
Protestantism.
Oh, dear. Isn't that what happened? Yep. If the church has a problem, what do? You protest, right? Well, another place where Paul describes the church and what its challenges are is in Ephesians 6, verses 11 to 17. Let me read a few verses of that. Put on the armor that God gives you so that you'll be able to stand up against the devil's evil tricks. For we are not fighting against human beings, but against the wicked spiritual forces in the heavenly world, the rulers, authorities, and cosmic powers of this dark age. So who would be included in the rulers, authorities, and cosmic powers of this dark age?
Politicians and business bankers and so on and so forth.
Well, he doesn't mention them by name.
Satan,
of course.
Satan is the leader of that group, isn't he?
That's right.
So put on God's armor now. Then when the evil day comes, you'll be able to resist the enemy's attacks, and after fighting to the end, you will still hold your ground. So what are the weapons you have? So stand ready with the truth as a belt tight round your waist, with righteousness as your breastplate. And as your shoes, the readiness to announce the good news of peace. At all times, carry faith as a shield, for with it you will be able to put out all the burning arrows shot by the evil one. So that helps us to understand who's fighting against us, right? And accept salvation as a helmet, and the word of God as a sword which the Spirit gives you. Do all this in prayer, asking for God's help. Pray on every occasion as the Spirit leads. For this reason, keep alert and never give up. Pray always for all God's people. Okay. So what are the weapons that Satan uses? We've talked now about the weapons that we're supposed to use to protect ourselves. What weapons does Satan use?
Lies, deception.
How do you deal with lies and deception?
You got to know what the truth is.
You have to know what the truth is, exactly. Can we defeat him using our own power? Never.
No.
Only by Bible study, prayer, and witnessing, and that's how we learn what's the truth, can we gain the spiritual weapons that the Holy Spirit will give us to enable us to overcome Satan. And then Ellen White put it in these words I thought were very appropriate. Great Controversy, page 593, paragraph 2. None but those who have fortified the mind with the truths of the Bible will stand through the last great conflict. To every soul will come the searching test. Shall I obey God rather than men? The decisive hour is even now at hand. Are our feet planted on the rock of God's immutable word? Are we prepared to stand firm in defense of the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus?
Ken, to that quote and to the bullet number 23, when you say the church bodies attack other parts of the church body,
yeah,
it seems today that you can see the church, some sect of inside the church attacking another. Almost every part of the church seems to be an attack in one way or another. So what's the best way to go to stand on your feet planted when everyone seems to be fighting everyone in some way or another?
I mean, that's a very good question. And the only way for us to put on the whole armor of God and not to be sucked into one of these parties is to make the Bible, and I would say the writings of Ellen White, prayer, witnessing, our number one task. We have our other work to do. It's not like we don't have other work to do. I'm a full-time physician. But we must remember that our first work, maybe not the one we have to spend the most time on, but our first work is always to try to represent God.
How do I know that my preconceived ideas don't have me locked into being one of these other groups that I shouldn't be?
Well, the only way, I mean, if I handed you a piece of paper about this size and had some green crayon scribbled on it and it said $100 bill, what would you do? Would you take it down to the store and spend it?
Well, no, because I've got a preconceived idea that's
exactly,
not the right
exactly. But now think about that.
The
closer it comes to looking like if I got the best counterfeiter in the world to make a fake $100 bill and I handed it to you, likely you would go down to the store and try to spend it. So what does that teach us?
But didn't Jesus, didn't he kind of come and try and dislodge some of these preconceived erroneous ideas?
Absolutely.
And so if I've got some preconceived erroneous ideas, and I don't know what they are, but I'm sure I do, and Johnny over here sees these preconceived erroneous ideas and how they're affecting my local congregation and maybe what's going on down at the school and this, that, and the other, what's he supposed to do about that?
Jesus told us specific. He says, if you see you have an argument with your brethren and that you disagree with them, you're supposed to sit down with them and you're supposed to talk about it. The purpose of having a church is we're supposed to be able to learn from each other.
How about Ephesians 5, 11? Mm-hmm. Take no part in the unfruitful work of darkness, but instead expose them.
Mm-hmm. Well, but I've been trying to do that to Johnny over here, and it's not working. And he's trying to do it to me.
Maybe he has the light and you don't.
Well, that's not my view.
I think we have to use the gospel as kind of an overlay, a kind of a filter as to we approach the Bible and all data that comes into our thinking.
Ellen White once said, and I'm paraphrasing here, no one who can't fairly evaluate an opinion different than his own is fit to teach in any part of God's work. We have to be willing to sit down with the Johnnies. Johnny, I don't know what we're picking on you.
It's all right.
He's used to it.
Or Gary. I can pick on Gary. Or Jim. When we sit down with people, we need to say, okay, what do you believe? Show me why. Show me your verses out of the Bible. Let's work this out.
Well,
we may have to consult more than one translation.
Yes.
Let me use Ellen White as an example in a famous story here with Loma Linda.
Yes.
She said, told Brother Burden, you need to buy this property. And the General Conference sent him a letter and said, don't do that. Yep. So
which do you think had the authority of God behind it?
So did they sit down there and just chat this out and work it out? Or did they just... So... Something's falling apart here.
Well, if you think there's a person who's giving you a direct message from God, that puts it in a slightly different category.
But we all think we're getting messages from God to do what we do.
Yeah.
Well, Ellen White had quite a bit of experience with that.
I think it supports what you said earlier, and I think we all know it. We've got to read and study.
Mm-hmm.
There comes a time somewhere at some time, and you've got to be like Luther. Here I stand. I can do no other.
But you know, evidently, the GC at that time, well, we just have to assume, maybe they didn't have all the information, but I think they probably had a pretty good idea, and you have to assume that evidently they didn't have quite the confidence they should have.
They didn't have the bigger picture. They were looking at the accountants. They were looking at the treasurer's report, and Ellen White says the treasurer's report isn't the whole story.
So how do we keep everything in the view of the big picture?
That the only way I know is to keep praying and keep studying the Bible and keep praying that God will direct us. I'm gonna take us back to the lesson because we still have a little ways to go. Paul talks a lot about the resurrection. Why do you think that was so important? I mean, let's be clear. First of all, sin pays its wage. The wage is what?
Death,
Romans 6:23. And 1 Corinthians 15, all the way through that chapter, he talks about what happened, the messages that were revealed to them. By the different people and how he was sort of born like out of place, so forth. And then finally in 1 Thessalonians 4, it talks about the resurrection. From the moment Jesus arrived as an infant on planet Earth, Satan's number one goal was to get him to sin. When he failed to accomplish that, as Jesus is approaching his death, Satan determined to make life so difficult for Jesus that he would give up and go back to heaven without finishing his mission on this earth. Failing that, Satan and his angels did everything they could to prevent Jesus from rising from the dead. But they failed in that final goal as well. And I quote, "When Jesus was laid in the grave, Satan triumphed. He dared to hope that the Savior would not take up his life again. He claimed the Lord's body and said, 'This is mine.' Set his goal above the tomb, set his guard above the tomb, seeking to hold Christ a prisoner. He was bitterly angry when his angels fled at the approach of the heavenly messenger. When he saw Christ come forth in triumph, he knew that his kingdom would have an end and that he must finally die." Desire of Ages 782.
Satan's claim has to do with death.
Mm-hmm. Sin, death. Yeah. Well, what did God say about that? Paul teaches us in his word that one day we corruptible and mortal beings can put on incorruption and immortality. God will give it to us. And Ellen White comments like this. This is Signs of the Times, November 4, 1908. It's in our Bible study guide. "Not only man, but the earth also had by sin come under the control of the wicked one and was to be restored by the plan of redemption. At his creation, Adam was placed in dominion over the earth, but by yielding to temptation, he was brought under the power of Satan, and the dominion which he held passed to his conqueror. Thus Satan became the god of this world. He had usurped that dominion over the earth which had been originally given to Adam. But Christ, by his sacrifice paying the penalty of sin, would not only redeem man, but recover the dominion which he had forfeited. All that was lost by the first Adam will be restored by the second, and I might add, even more than what was lost by the first Adam. So, how do you feel about living in a death-dominated world, ruled over largely by Satan himself?
It's not the best.
Not the best?
Well, but if you are what you are supposed to be, you will suffer a temporary, very likely you'll suffer a temporary death here.
Okay.
But you're really experiencing eternal life. I consider myself experiencing eternal life already, even though I may have a bit of sleep.
You're claiming
a long nap here one of these days.
You're claiming John 17:3. This is life eternal, to know God, right? Well, as we approach the end of this world's history, God will gradually withdraw his restraining powers and allow Satan to have even more control. Why would God do that?
Well, to
evil has to be demonstrated for what it really is.
Evil. Really see the whole full blitz. It's bad enough as it is now, but it isn't. God is protecting everybody and everything. And at that time, he will stand back and just let Satan have his way, and you'll see what sin is really does.
Yeah, exactly. That will be a scary time to be alive, but it will also be an exciting time for those who understand the final outcome of the great controversy. And elsewhere, Ellen White repeats some of the same words we read a few moments ago, Adventist Review, Sabbath Herald of January 20 of 1903. Enfeebled and defective, needing constantly to be warned and counseled. You want to know how we're going to get things straightened out? Here we have it. God is constantly warning and counseling us. The church is nevertheless the object of Christ's supreme regard. He is making experiments of grace on human hearts and is effecting such transformations of character that angels are amazed. You're going to save Ken Hart? Would you dare to do that? Well, the angels are amazed and express their joy in songs of praise. They rejoice to think that sinful, erring human beings can be so transformed. Well, how do you feel about all these metaphors that Paul talks about? The building and the different parts of the body and the houses, foundations of Jesus Christ, etc. Do those help us in trying to understand the great controversy?
Certainly hope so.
I think
he wasted his time with those.
Do they help us to relate better to our fellow church members?
It should.
Hope so.
It's good to have an understanding why so many of these other people are in error.
Yeah. What can we do on a day-by-day basis that demonstrates that we are clearly on God's side in the great controversy? Do we live day-by-day as if we really believe that Satan is a defeated foe? There's a couple of very powerful verses. Isaiah 28, verse 8. I'm reading again, of course, from my Good News Bible. The sovereign Lord will destroy death forever. He will wipe away the tears from everyone's eyes and take away the disgrace his people have suffered throughout the world. The Lord himself has spoken. And then 1 Corinthians 15:54-55. So when this takes place and the mortal has been changed into the immortal, then the scripture will come true. Death is destroyed. Victory is complete. Where death is your victory, where death is your power to hurt. Clearly, this lesson teaches that the church needs to work toward unity, but not uniformity. We cannot all have the same talents or be exactly alike. But we should rejoice in our differences so long as we are all pulling in the same direction. When we place our trust in Jesus and allow the Holy Spirit to have access to our minds and lives on a regular basis, we will be transformed over time to become more and more like Jesus himself. Great Controversy 5:55. Christ and his righteousness, let this be our platform, the very life of our faith, that which he taught we are to teach. His commission to his followers is, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Review and Herald, August 31, 1905. Having a right relationship with God and being changed on a day-by-day basis to become more like him is the very essence of our message. Several have written to me, Ellen White said, inquiring if the message of justification by faith is the third angel's message, and I have answered, it is a third angel's message in verity. Review and Herald, April 1, 1890, just a short time after the 1888 General Conference. So now, having discussed all this, how do you understand the difference of what happened to us as a result of the first Adam and what has happened to us as a result of the second Adam?
That's pretty fancy theological terms you've got there.
Yeah. Would it be true that if Christ is not going to come back, there would be no reason for him to have come the first time? Ever thought about that? So he went through some incredible things. He must have had some good reason for doing it. Satan and his evil host recognize that they are in battle, a battle for their very existence. If a group of us develop the kind of faith relationship with Jesus Christ that characterized the first disciples on the day of Pentecost, and thus receive the latter rain, Satan's doom is sealed. Shouldn't we be praying for that every day? Does Satan really understand and accept the idea that he's a defeated foe? Or after 2,000 years, does he think he's doing pretty well? Do his angels understand and accept that they are defeated foes? What do they say to each other about that problem of theirs? Well, in this context, what is the essential unity that God is looking for among us? Could the Seventh-day Adventist Church, as a worldwide organization with people from hundreds of different cultures and languages, ever present a unified front? We have talked about a lot of things from the writings of Paul. We've talked about a lot of things from the writings of Ellen White, trying to expound, helping us to understand this. And we have been given a challenge. It's yours now. Our wonderful Father, we have just spent some time looking at your revealed word, realizing the challenges that you have placed before us to become like you. We claim the power of the Holy Spirit. We claim the presence of the Holy Spirit in our lives to make those kinds of changes. We know we can't do that on our own, not a ghost of a chance. But the Holy Spirit can do it. There's nothing wrong with his work. It's not defective in any way. And may that be experience of all of us here and all those who are listening around the world, today and in the near future, so that we may soon be able to look up and see you coming in the clouds, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.